ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमम् देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिके। मूकं करोति वाचालं बंगुलंगयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनदारणं श्रीपरमानन्दमाधवम्। So today we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto, chapter 11, text 5. The name of this chapter is The Perfect Society, 4 Social Classes. Sri Narada Ubhacha Natva Bhagavate Jaya लोकानां धर्मसेतवे भक्षे सनातनं धर्मं नारायण मुखाश्रितं। श्री नारद उवाच नत्ते भगवते भगवते अजाय लोकानां धर्मसेतवे भक्षे सनातनं धर्मं नारायण मुखाश्रितं। श्री नारद उवाच नत्वा भगवते अजाय लोकानां धर्मसेतवे भक्षे सनातनं धर्मं नारायण मुखाश्रितं। श्री नारद उवाच। श्री नारद मुनि सेड नत्वा Offering my obeisances, Bhagavate, unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Ajaya, ever existing, never born, Lokanam, throughout the entire universe, Dharma Setave, who protects religious principles. Bhakshe, I shall explain. Sanatanam, eternal. Dharmam, occupational duty. Narayana mukhat, from the mouth of Narayana. Srutam, which I have heard. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada. Translation. Sri Narada Muni said, after first offering my obeisances unto Lord Krishna, the protector of the religious principles of all living entities, let me explain the principles of the eternal religious system of which I have heard from the mouth of Narayan. Purport. The word Aja refers to Krishna, who explains in Bhagavad Gita 4.6, Ajo Pisan Abhyatma. I am ever existing, and thus I never take birth. There is no change in my existence. Very short purport. Om Jnanati Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Sayang Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Sopadantikam Bandeham Sri Guru Sri Tapada Kamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavansa Sri Rupam Sakrajatam Sagana Raghunatha Nitantam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Saganalita Sri Visakhanitam Sa He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vishavanusate Devi Pranamami Hari Priya Vancha Kalpataru Vyascha Krupa Sindhu Bhevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo 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 Mahavadanaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaurati Se Namah Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare
Natva Bhagavate Ajaya Lokanang Dharma Setave Bhakshya Sanatanang Dharma Narayana Mukhasrutam. So here in this verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, Narad Muni is going to answer the questions of Maharaj Yudhishthira. As we have heard earlier,
that Narada Muni was describing the glories of Prahlad Maharaj. The spiritual master of Prahlad Maharaj, Srila Narada Muni, he was glorifying his own disciple. And when Yudhishthira Maharaj heard this, he became very, very pleased. Hearing the glories of Prahlad Maharaj. And because Yudhishthira Maharaj was also the emperor of the whole world, at the same time, he was also a great pure devotee of the Lord. He also wanted that his Jaya Sri Sri Gauranga, Sri Krishna Balaram, Sri Radha, Sam Sundaral, Sri Ki Jaya. So he also wanted to know about the eternal religious principles by following which the people of this world attain the ultimate goal of life, that is devotional service to the Lord. And that was the duty of the king or the emperor, to engage the citizens or subjects in their occupational duties and ultimately attain the ultimate goal of life. Though Yudhishthira Maharaj knew all these things, but still, for the benefit of others, he was asking this question to Narada Muni to speak about the eternal religious principles by which one can attain the ultimate goal of life, that is devotional service. So after hearing this question of Yudhishthira Maharaj, now Narada Muni is going to explain to him about the eternal religious principles. So, Narada Muni, first what he did, Natva Bhagavate Ajaya. So, before speaking, Narada Muni is one of the Mahajans. Among 12 Mahajans, we have Narada Muni there. And he is teaching by his own example. That sometimes we may study so many different scriptures and we may also become proud of our knowledge. And we think we know everything, we can speak everything. But just by studying scriptures, one may speak very nicely, but the real realization of the knowledge would come from the heart. It is not just by studying the scriptures. Oh, there is one jnana and there is vijnana. So knowledge we can acquire from studying different scriptures, but not vijnana, the realized knowledge. And how that will come? By pleasing Guru and Krishna. So when every day we are worshipping spiritual master, we are singing Divya Gana Hruday Prakashita. This transcendental knowledge will be revealed within the heart of a person who is surrendered fully to the spiritual master and Krishna. And that realized knowledge, when it's spoken, that touches the heart of other people, other living entities. We see the professional speakers, they study so many scriptures, they have so much knowledge, and they present the knowledge in such a nice way, pleasing way, people become attracted to them. and they pay lakhs of rupees just to hear from them. But what is the result? This is just some entertainment program. It becomes like entertainment program. None of them become a devotee of Krishna. To become a devotee of Krishna, the knowledge has to touch the heart of the person. Then he will change. And we see Srila Prabhupada, whenever he was giving lecture, mostly he was speaking for half an hour only, not much. All of Prabhupada's lectures are only half an hour lectures. But whenever Prabhupada spoke, he was speaking from his realization. And it was touching the hearts of not only one person, thousands of persons. And we see within 12 years, Prabhupada started this movement and established this movement and changed the hearts of thousands of people. They all became devotees. So this is the result of a realized, preaching of a realized soul. So when a realized soul speaks, he speaks from the heart, not by just give some scholarly presentation or just to try to entertain the public. So here Narad Muni is one of our Mahajans. So when he is going to speak, what he is doing, natva, first he is offering his obeisances. And that generally the devotees do. And Srila Prabhupada also prayed for his Guru Maharaj, mercy of Krishna. So by the mercy of Guru and Krishna, we will be able to speak. Not by studying scriptures, we will be able to speak. So the realized knowledge will come by the mercy of Guru and Krishna. So Narad Muni here, at first, though he was a very learned person, very learned devotee, he knew everything. Even the Yudhishthira Maharaj is telling, you know everything. But still, he offered his humble obeisances. To whom? To Krishna. And wanted the mercy of Krishna to speak about Krishna. Because who can speak about Krishna unless he gets the mercy of Krishna? So Krishna speaks through the heart. Like Srila Prabhupada used to say, when he was writing all these Vedic scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, so he was telling, Krishna was speaking through him. And sometimes Prabhupada himself would read his own books, which he had written. So Krishna was speaking through Prabhupada, because the pure devotee of the Lord, he becomes a bhaya media, through which Krishna actually gives that knowledge to spread that knowledge for the benefit of mankind. So here we see Narad Muni at first offering his obeisances to the Supreme Lord Krishna, who is Ajah. And specifically, Narad Muni is using the word Ajah. Ajah means who never takes birth, Ajanma. That means that person is eternal person. Because sometimes people may not believe in Krishna. They may think, sometimes people say, Krishna was a historical person, or someone may say he is an imaginary person. One time one person told like this to me, that Krishna was an imaginary person, one newspaper reporter. Then I asked him, why do you say like this, that Krishna was an imaginary person? Then he said, who has seen Krishna? No one has seen Krishna. Then I asked him, have you seen your great-grandfather? Then he said, no. Then I said, okay, now I will tell that your great-grandfather is an imaginary person. So after this, he kept silence. He could not speak anything. Then I explained to him that even if you have not seen your great-grandfather, but you accept that you have heard about your great-grandfather from your father, from your grandfather. So how can you say because you have not seen, so your great-grandfather was not there? So in the same way, after 100 years, someone would write the family history of yours, he would have not seen anyone, but he would write the family history. That means others will say that all were imaginary person. So in the same way, this Bhagavatam and Mahabharata, they are history of India. And you might have not seen Krishna, but so many people saw Krishna. They described about Krishna. So how can you say that Krishna was an imaginary person? He was completely silent. He could not speak anything. Anyway, so many people, they say like this. So here, that's why Narad Muni is specifically using the word ajar, who never takes birth. Because when someone takes birth, then taking birth means death is certain. Jatasya hi dhruvang mrityu, dhruvang janma mrityasya cha. So anyone who will take birth, he will die one day. And then he will forget his previous life, then he will start his new life. So if Krishna would be a person who was taking birth, then the next thing would come that he also left his body. So then someone may say that, okay, if Krishna was like us, then what is the use of his knowledge? What knowledge he gave? That's why Narad Muni is using the word aja. Means he is offering his respectful obeisances to a person who never takes birth. That means who is eternal, eternally existing. And we are all mortal beings. We are taking birth and then leaving our body. So our knowledge or conception about life is useless. But the person who is ever existing, who is creating this material world, creating all living entities, he knows everything. Only he is eligible to give this knowledge. No one else can give this knowledge. Even Lord Brahma, the first living entity, he was also born in darkness. He did not know anything when he was born. Like all of us, we take birth in ignorance. Darkness is ignorance. And Brahma has to perform austerity to purify his existence and get the mercy of the Lord. And the Lord instructed Brahma about this transcendental knowledge. Then Brahma became knowledgeable and he gave this knowledge to Narada and others. So the real knowledge is coming from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, because he is ever existing. All other living entities, they are subject to birth, death, old age and disease. So they cannot give eternal knowledge because they are born in ignorance. So Narada Muni, he is first offering his obeisances to a person, Supreme Person, who is ever existing, who is eternal, and that is Krishna. As Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, janma karmam cha me divyam evam jo vetti tattvatah tetta deham punarjanma naiti mahameti sarjana. So anyone who understands Krishna's birth and activities as transcendental, he'll never take birth again in this material world. So that means Krishna's birth is also, though it appears that Krishna took birth, but he just appeared. Like Prabhupada always gives the example of the sun. The sun appears every day in the morning. We don't say that now, today the sun took birth. We never say that, because we know the sun is ever existing. So in the same way, Krishna is ever existing. Sometimes he appears and sometimes he disappears from our vision. So that does not mean that Krishna is taking birth, and when birth comes, then death will come. But Krishna is free from birth, death, old age and disease. He is Satchidananda Vigraha. So that Krishna who is eternal, Narada Muni is paying his obeisances. Why? To get his mercy, to get the knowledge, transcendental knowledge from Krishna. He is the source of all knowledge. And he is sitting within the heart of every living entity as Paramatma. Sarvasya chaham hrudi sannivishto matta smriti jnanam apohanam. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that I am sitting in everyone's heart, and from me knowledge comes. From me forgetfulness comes. From me remembrance comes. So Krishna is controlling, sitting in our heart. He has a remote control with him. We may think we are very knowledgeable, I can remember everything. But Krishna is controlling how much we can remember, how much knowledge we get. He is controlling. That's why Narada Muni is offering his respectful obeisances to Krishna, so he would reveal this knowledge within his heart, so he would be able to speak to Maharaj Yudhishthira. So though he was very knowledgeable, still he was always dependent on the mercy of Krishna. And in that way, Narada Muni was actually teaching us that how we should be always dependent on the mercy of Krishna. Whatever we have, whatever knowledge, whatever power, whatever renunciation, whatever wealth, whatever intelligence, whatever glory we get, it is all because of the mercy of Krishna. Without Krishna's mercy, we are all useless. We cannot do anything. So here, Narada Muni is first invoking the mercy of Krishna by offering his respectful obeisances at the lotus feet of Krishna. He is invoking his mercy, so he will be able to speak Yudhishthira Maharaj's questions. He would be able to answer. So then he says, Lokanang dharma sevitave. And again, he is telling about Krishna that he is Aja, he never takes birth, that's why he has no death, no old age and disease, he is ever existing, and he is dharma sevitave. Because Yudhishthira Maharaj has asked him about religious principles. That what religious principles the general populace should follow, by which they can attain the ultimate goal of life. So now, why Narada Muni offered his obeisance to Krishna? Because Lokanang Dharma Sevitave. He is eternally existing, and at the same time, he is Lokanang Dharma Sevitave. Dharma Sevitave. Sevitave means setu. From setu, word setu, it has become setave. Setu means dam. So to protect water, generally we build dams, which stops the flow of the water. and we protect that water for future use. So here Narad Muni is telling Dharma Setave that Lord Krishna, he is Setu, he is like a dam or a protector of what? Na Dharma. He is the protector of eternal religious principles. And not only protector, even it has been described in the scriptures that what is dharma? Generally, people misunderstand this dharma. Sometimes people, they speculate so many things and they say, oh, this is my dharma. So they don't know actually what is their dharma and what is to be called dharma. So according to Srimad Bhagavatam, dharma tu sakshat bhagavata pranitam. This dharma or the religious principles, it is directly enunciated by the Supreme Lord Himself. Because no one else can speak about this eternal religious principles. Only Krishna can speak about eternal religious principles because He is the source of everything. He is eternal and the source of material and spiritual worlds. Source of all living entities. And why these eternal religious principles have been given by Krishna? For the benefit of all living entities. And specifically human beings. Because human beings are supposed to follow the eternal religious principles. Others are not meant to follow that. The animals cannot understand this. So this is specifically meant for human beings. And human beings, how they don't know what is their ultimate benefit. How they can get out of this cycle of birth and death, from these miseries of this material world, and attain eternal happiness. And because general people, they don't know about this, that's why what they do, they're trying in so many ways to get some material sense gratification. And they're thinking by this they can become happy. But no one becomes happy with that. They may become temporarily happy, but this material sense gratification does not give eternal happiness. And people don't know generally how can they attain eternal happiness. That's why these religious principles are required. And that is given by the Supreme Lord for the benefit of human beings. So the Supreme Lord, He is giving the religious principles by which people can become eternally happy and get out of this cycle of birth and death, from these miseries of this material world. And at the same time, the Supreme Lord is also protecting these eternal religious principles. Not only He is giving this, He is also protecting time to time. That's why in Bhagavad Gita Krishna says, whenever there is a decline of religious principles, then He appears. Yada yada dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata. Abhyuthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. So Krishna appears time to time just to protect these religious principles. Because if these religious principles are not protected, then irreligion takes over. And when irreligion will spread, then there will be no way the human beings can attain any happiness. So their suffering will increase. That's why the Supreme Lord is always very considerate to make an arrangement for the human beings, because then the Supreme Lord knows the human beings are in ignorance. So he is making the arrangement by which people can follow these religious principles and improve themselves to a spiritual life by which they can attain the ultimate goal of life, the eternal devotional service to the Supreme Lord. So here we see that Narad Muni, he is also using another word for the Supreme Lord, another adjective for the Supreme Lord, that is Dharma Setave. The Supreme Lord is the protector of religious principles. Lokanam, of all the planetary systems and all human beings, he is protecting their religious principles. And Bhakshe Sanatana Dharma. So after offering his obeisances to the Supreme Lord, now Narad Muni is going to speak. By getting the mercy of the Supreme Lord, he is going to speak. And he is going to speak about what? Bhakshe Sanatana Dharma. So he is going to speak about eternal religious principles by which people can become eternally happy. People are looking for temporary happiness, but Narad Muni is going to speak for eternal happiness, how people can become eternally happy. So he describes later on, there are many chapters on this, where Narad Muni is describing the Sanatana Dharma, about this Varnashrama Dharma. So people can at least start their religious life from this Varnashrama Dharma. As we know, there are 4 Varnas and 4 Ashramas, and Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, and then Brahmacharya Ashram, Grihastha Ashram, Vanaprastha Ashram, and Sannyasa Ashram. So 4 Varnas and 4 Ashramas, and their prescribed duties are also mentioned by Narad Muni. But this knowledge is not coming from Narad Muni. Narad Muni is telling, now I am going to speak about this Varnashrama Dharma or eternal religious principles, which includes Varnashrama Dharma. And Narad Muni is not telling of his own. He is telling Narayana Mukhat Srutam, that I will tell those religious principles, Sanatana Dharma, whatever I have heard from Lord Narayana. Narayana Mukhat Srutam. Whatever I have heard from the mouth of Lord Narayana. That means he is not speculating on religious principles. Or he is not manufacturing his own dharma. Like nowadays in Kali Yuga, we see so many people, they are manufacturing their religion. That's why people are misguided, bewildered in this age of Kali. Which religion they have to follow? One person is telling one thing, another person is telling another thing. So another person telling another thing, so people are bewildered. That which path is the right path? Which religion is the right religion? They don't know. And they see, oh, thousands of people are following this religion, okay, let us go. Like the ships. If one ship will go in one way, then all ships would follow him. It is said in Hindi, this is Bhediya Dhasan. So once it goes in one line, then others, without thinking, they will just follow it. The same thing is happening in this age of Kali. Because people have no idea about the
eternal religious principles. And seeing this, many pseudo-religionists, they manufacture their own religions and in that way misguide people for their own benefit. That's what Narad Muni is also going to describe in 15th chapter about other dharmas, vidharma, paradharma, chava dharma, avasa dharma, upadharma, some five kinds of irreligion. He's going to speak how people are cheating in this age of Kali. In the name of a religion, a cheating business is going on. That's why we have to know what is real religion. And that has to come from the supreme authority, that is from Krishna. No one can manufacture religion. The problem in this age of Kali is that people are manufacturing religion. But religion cannot be manufactured by one's whims. So we have to follow the supreme authority, that is Krishna, who is giving these religious principles for the benefit of others, for the benefit of human beings. But when we manufacture religion, because we are subject to so many imperfections, that's why whatever we manufacture, that will be defective. That will not be for the eternal benefit of human beings. But whatever Krishna gives, that is perfect. In every respect, perfect religion. That's why Narad Muni is speaking that religion which is coming from the mouth of Lord Narayan. Whatever he has heard from the mouth of Narayan directly, he is going to speak about that religious principles, by which actually the people of this world will be benefited and Yudhishthira Maharaj will be satisfied. Because as an emperor, he is going to implement these religious principles for the benefit of his subjects. That's why he wants to hear this from the mouth of Narad Muni, and in that way he is going to implement that. So in this way we see that Narad Muni is going to speak about those eternal religious principles, and specifically he is going to speak Sanatana Dharma, the eternal religious principles, which starts from Varnashrama Dharma. That the prescribed duties which have been assigned by the Supreme Lord to every Varna and every Ashram. And just by following that, one can uplift oneself to a higher stage of surrendering at the lotus feet of Krishna. But the goal of following these prescribed duties or this Varnashrama Dharma is Sansiddhi Haritosanam. So all Varnas and all Ashrams have to perform their prescribed duties according to their guna, not by birth, according to their guna, to satisfy Lord Hari. That is the goal of following Varnashrama Dharma. And when one does that, then one uplifts, one comes to the platform of satisfying Lord Hari. Then he makes advancement in spiritual life. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu met Ramananda Rai, and he asked about these eternal religious principles, Ramananda Rai started from this Varnashrama Dharma. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, "Yaha bhaya ar kahar." So this Varnashrama Dharma is the basic thing that all human beings can follow. But the eternal religious principles, which is higher,
than this is to satisfy Lord Hari. So here we see that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said, Eho Bahya. Varnasrama Dharma is Bahya, external. Speak something better than this. Then Ramananda Raya said, Karmarapana, offering the results of one's activities. Still Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not satisfied. He said, Eho Bahya, Arkava. But when Ramananda Raya said, to give up everything and surrender at the lotus feet of the Lord, then Chaitanya said, Eho Hai. Okay, this is all right. But you speak something more. Then it goes on. So that means these basic principles are given, but there are higher principles. This is dharma, but there is paro-dharma, higher dharma. And what is that higher dharma? Sabai punsa paro-dharma, yato bhakti adhokhyase. Ahetuki apratiyata, yajatma suprasidati. So the paro-dharma, the higher religious principle is bhakti, devotional service to adhokhyaja. Sabai punsa paro dharma jato bhakti adhokhyaja. And that bhakti, pure devotional service, should be ahetuki apratihata. There should not be any material reason for that to perform pure devotional service, and that cannot be obstructed by any means. So that bhakti, when one performs pure devotional service to Krishna, to satisfy Krishna, then jayatma su prasidati. Then the soul will become satisfied. When we get some sense gratification, we say our soul is satisfied. But that is not the soul, that is the mind. But the soul will be satisfied when we perform devotional service at the lotus feet of Krishna. That is supreme dharma. And when we perform that supreme dharma, then we actually attain the ultimate goal of life. So Narada Muni is going to explain the different stages of Sanatana Dharma or eternal religious principles. We'll hear later on. So I'll stop here. Hare Krishna. So if there are any comments or questions. Okay. Thank you very much. Jai Grantharasimad Bhagavatam ki. Jai Srila Prabhupada Maharaj ki. Jai Gaurabhakta Vrinda ki. Nitai Gaur Pramanande Hari.